All right, we are joined today by a very special guest, Reggie Love, who's got one of the coolest resumes in all of DC. He is a national champion men's basketball player with the 2001 Duke Blue Devils. He was the body man to Senator and then President Barack Obama. He's got his MBA from Wharton. He did a stint at Vice Media. And most recently, he endorsed Mayor Pete Buttigieg back in December 2019. Reggie, thanks for joining us in the studio.
Christian, thank you for having me.
Yeah, no problem.
Love being here today with you guys.
Awesome. So I just want to start out, address the elephant in the room. Obviously, you spent years on Team Obama. Why did you decide to endorse Mayor Pete Buttigieg over Vice President Joe Biden?
Yeah, look, I mean, I would say that obviously working with President Obama and Vice President Joe Biden for the many years that I did was one of the best experiences of my life. I also have an immense amount of respect for their public service and for all the things that they've done throughout their careers for the country. You know, in terms of my support for Pete, I just think Mayor Pete has something special. It kind of reminds me of Obama in 2008. You know, I think the country is like at a very unique point in time right now. I think it's an inflection point. I think the divisiveness has increased over the years, and I think if we really want to have a great chance for Democrats to win in 2020 in the fall, I think we've got to have a candidate that's going to inspire people to want to be a part of something that's bigger than themselves. They're going to want to go out to vote because not around the idea that they're just unhappy with the current situation, but that they want to be a part of something else. Like they want policies and they want thoughtfulness and they want someone that can inspire them to bring about generational change.
I know you just spoke a little bit on some of the positives that Pete brings to the table. One thing that I've noticed, especially on the debate stage, is he's a little bit of a fighter. He's got that in common with Trump. Do you think that gives him a leg up on some of the other Democratic frontrunners in terms of facing off against Trump in the general?
Look, I think in terms of interfacing with Trump, you know, it will be, as we saw in 2016, like there are no real limits in terms of what he will or will not do. Mm-hmm. I don't really believe that the story here is who's going to be the person to go out and prove to the country that somehow that they're better than Trump or somehow they're tougher than Trump. I think people want something that's different than that. You know, the back and forth, the fighting. I think people want policies and they want ideas that are going to help them solve the problems that are living on their kitchen table and living in their communities and living, you know, and with their families. You know, everything from stuff around the criminal justice system, wealth inequality, access to education, access to affordable health care. I mean, those are the real things that people, I think, care about. And I think those are the things that are going to get people fired up to want to vote in this fall in 2020. And I think those are the things that will get people who haven't participated in the political process in the last couple of cycles, or people who are a little bit more moderate and, you know, maybe they're Democratic, maybe they're Republican. I think bringing a coalition and bringing people together unified to, you know, to continue to execute on the things that have made this country great are, you know, I think that's the core of what I think Pete will be able to bring. And I think when you look at some of the other candidates, some of their ideas and some of their approaches are a little more divisive.
Okay, speaking of that coalition you just touched on, one of Mayor Buttigieg's biggest hurdles is his favorability numbers among Black voters, especially in the South, where Joe Biden is wildly popular. How is the campaign sort of trying to address this specifically? Obviously, you're a well-known figure from your days in the Obama administration and dating back to Duke. But I mean, it's a serious problem.
Yeah. Well, look, I can't say that I was well-known at anything. But look, what I do know is I had a great experience working on the Obama campaign. And one of the things that I learned is that all the polls, they don't really mean anything until people actually get to know you. Mm-hmm. And I think for Mayor Pete, he's not been on the national scene as long as others, very similar to a Hillary Clinton and a Barack Obama. In the summer of 2007, every poll and its mom said that Hillary Clinton was definitely going to be the Democratic nominee. And I think if candidates, and I think Mayor Pete has this in him, if they're willing to go out and to talk to people, explain their message, work, build trust, build relationships, do the things that it takes in order to earn someone's vote, I think he'll be able to resonate with not only the folks in Iowa on that we hope will caucus for him on February 3rd, but also people in South Carolina and people in Florida. And I think when you have this message of unity and of something that's more like a movement, I think you are able to campaign not only in South Carolina as a primary, I think you're able to campaign in 50 states because people are hungry for this right now.
You were obviously with Obama during his Senate years, during his first term in the White House, but you've been out of government for almost 10 years now, nearly a full decade. Seven years? Okay.
Yeah.
Would you consider joining the administration if Mayor Pete wins?
So the last time someone asked me this question, it was when Trump won. And I will say the same thing that I said then, is that if the President of the United States asked me to come serve or help the country, I think it's something you definitely I would consider, because I think there's nothing more important than service. Like, if you have an ability to make a difference and have an impact for American people, I don't think there's a better feeling in the world.
I'm glad you touched on 2016, because Trump campaigned in large part on rolling back a lot of the progress that the Obama administration put on the table. And he has done a lot of that, especially with some of the coal regulations, other issues. How does that make you feel? Do you feel this is like a direct repudiation of the Obama legacy?
Well, I would say that it's funny, because one of the biggest things that Trump said he was going to do, he still hasn't done. I think President Obama has done one of the most historic things since FDR, which is to make healthcare a basic human right. Mm-hmm. The Affordable Care Act is by far one of the most comprehensive and one of the most impactful pieces of legislation that's happened to this country in quite some time. And people are happy with it. You know, people want it. And even though, you know, Trump has sort of indicated that he will, you know, he's going to like make it better or do whatever, it's like, if you can make it better, go for it. I'd love it. You know, as long as it's based off the principle that, you know, Americans are going to have the ability to have a floor when it comes to access to healthcare that's affordable and accessible, I'm all for it. In terms of the coal rolling back some of the things that he's done on in the energy sector on clean coal, I mean, I think with the prices where natural gas is right now, I think it won't really have an impact. Now, look, if someone decided that they were going to look differently at the impacts of natural gas as it has a, you know, and its impact on global warming, and you have more regulatory there, I think what Trump has done around coal could actually, you know, bring back a lot of unclean practices for power generation, which I'm not really for. I don't see that happening, so I'm not like as concerned. I think when it comes to parts of the world that Trump spoke to around, we want to bring back coal, you know, in my mind, I think it would be better to figure out how to revitalize that part of the country, right? Mm-hmm. I think a lot of these communities in rural America, you know, they need resources, they need more people, they need access to better jobs, they need retraining, they need to be reskilled. And I think Pete's plan around what he can do for rural America, you know, and given the fact that he's from Indiana and lived and he's been on the ground in South Bend, I think he ends up being a very interesting candidate to speak to that in a meaningful way and to understand a lot of those challenges that those communities are having and to work with them to figure it out. You know, you've got a whole host of issues that are ravaging parts of rural America, and I think having someone who knows it firsthand from on the ground, I think, you know, would be very, very impactful.
Speaking of Pete's plan, all of the Democratic primary candidates, I think with the exception of Biden and Michael Bloomberg, have come out for legalizing marijuana in some capacity. But Mayor Pete is taking that a step further. He said we should legalize all drug use, not necessarily for recreational means, but as sort of a means to bring about criminal justice reform. I was wondering if you could touch on the rationale of that a little bit and just why he decided to go that far, given what you just talked about, issues affecting rural communities like the opioid crisis.
If you statistically look at the impact on the criminal justice system in terms of people who are imprisoned for marijuana use versus people who have issues with opioids. Most people who have issues with opioids don't end up in prison. Mm-hmm. They typically end up in rehab or they end up in some facility. So personally, I would say treatment and education are really the best things to help, you know, keep people from ending up being addicted to these different types of substances. And that is for not, that's for these prescription drugs and the opioids. That's also for, you know, recreational drugs as well. In terms of why he took it a step further, I'm not, you know, look, my best guess is that if you look at the criminal justice system now, it's filled with a lot of people who have been convicted and been in prison for nonviolent crimes. I think Barack Obama went pretty far in decriminalizing crack cocaine, right? Mm-hmm. Like, he basically went back and pardoned a lot of people who had been in prison for a long time for having used some of these substances that had been brought down a level. And I think ultimately, when you look at how much it costs a community and how much it costs the country to have people be in prison, that the impact that it has on an individual who has a felony listed on their background, you know, it keeps them from being able to get access to jobs. It doesn't allow them to vote. I think what Pete is trying to do is trying to create opportunities to keep people a part of the community, to help people be hopeful about their opportunities and where mm-hmm. they can go in the future. And I think that's the most important thing when you think about community building, right? And as someone like Pete, who spent so much time on the ground, I think it's an aspirational thing that can have an impact.
No, I think you're definitely right. And this is a very bipartisan issue. We've even seen some Republicans sort of trending that way. It's not necessarily carrying the social stigma it did in the past. Yeah. I'm glad more politicians are sort of taking that view on the issue. We knocked out all the tough ones, all okay. the meat. Got a couple more fun questions for all you. Right.
Let me I like
let you get
ones.
Out here, hit all the right. campaign trail again.
So back to South Carolina.
Oh yeah. You're a Blue Devil. You got a national championship under your belt.
Yep.
2015.
Okay.
Blue Devils are playing Wisconsin. Duke gets maybe a questionable call. They get the ball back in the waning seconds of the game. Hit a dagger to put them up six. We all saw the tape. Did Justice Winslow touch that ball?
Look, man, I think 2015, Indianapolis, Duke versus Wisconsin, I think that was one of the best games. I mean, it was, you know, something else. But I don't know. I don't think he did.
Okay.
I was there in person. I never actually saw the replay of it.
Yeah.
But in person, it looked like the right call.
All right.
What do you think?
As an opponent of video replay, go with the refs. Human error is part of the game. Human getting things right is part of the game. But anyway, we're not going to relitigate the past. Let's talk about the future. Coach K, he's had some health issues. The team isn't necessarily as great as it was in 2015. They haven't won a national championship in a couple of years. How long do you think he's staying with the program? I mean, he's the greatest coach of all time. Let's get that up front.
I would say he's definitely one of the best college coaches in history. I mean, obviously Wooden still, mm-hmm. you know, that guy lives pretty high up there. I had the chance to meet him. But look, the team, it's a high bar, man. It's like, mm-hmm. are you only a great coach if you win a national championship? I don't think that's necessarily the case. I'd say, look, this team right now doesn't have as many NBA prospects as the past couple of teams in the past, but if you look at them, I mean, they play hard, they play really good together, they play well together. Irrespective of the caliber of recruits that come in, I think Coach K is very good at getting guys to play as a group and to play as a unity and as a unit and to play together. And I think when you play that way, you're able to like you're able to be pretty competitive irrespective of the quality of talent right now. It can't go down too far, right?
Well, it's Duke. They're never going to go down too far.
Right. And in terms of how long he coaches, look, man, I think as long as he gets up every day and is excited to coach the game, I think he'll continue to be out there. You know, assuming that you wake up and you physically can do it. But he looks pretty good still. He's got some new hips and new knees and all that kind of stuff.
He's got the RoboCop treatment, and his hair is still jet black. I don't know if that's natural or not, but he looks good. He looks good for an older fellow for sure. Yeah. Well, Reggie, that's about all the time we got today. I know you are heading out to South Carolina almost immediately after this. So wish you well on the campaign trail, and hopefully we can get you in another time soon to talk about the campaign.
All right. Well, Christian, thank you for having me, and I hope everyone has a great weekend.